Hello and welcome to the third video in the series Machine Learning Foundations. In our previous video, we talked about the machine learning pipeline and the different career landscapes in machine learning. In this video, we will discuss about the different types of tasks that can be solved using machine learning. Let's start the video now. Remember, we discussed two examples in the first video of this series. In the first example, we had to categorize whether the given image is a cat or dog image. Image categorization is a type of classification task. That is, the problem of categorizing instances into predefined classes. With just two categories, that is cat and dog, it is specifically a binary classification problem. Suppose if we also had images of lions in our data, and our task would have been to categorize images into cat, dog, or lion categories. Classification tasks involving more than two categories are known as multi-class classification problems. In a multi-class scenario, the categories are mutually exclusive. In some scenarios, like if we also had images where the dog and cat are present together in the same image, then this image may simultaneously belong to multiple classes. In this case, cat and dog. That is, the categories are not mutually exclusive. Such tasks are known as multi-labeled classification problems. Whether binary or multi-class, the categorical outputs are discrete variables. If the desired outputs are real-valued numbers, then we are dealing with the task of regression. Remember the second example, where we had some XY pairs to train on and had to predict the value of Y when X was 8. This was a regression problem. Another example can be, you may need to predict the selling price, that is a real number, of a house given its location, area, lot size, etc. Regression and classification both utilize training examples with known categories or expected outputs. These form of examples are known as supervised examples, with supervision referring to the categories or the expected output. This particular machine learning paradigm is known as supervised learning. Some machine learning tasks do not utilize supervision. For example, in case of spam email classification, instead of assigning emails to the predefined categories, we may just wish to automatically discover their natural groupings, maybe based on the similarity of their content. The task of discovering groupings in a set of examples is known as a clustering problem. These discovered groups are known as clusters. So if you train a clustering algorithm with a large number of spam and non-spam emails, the ideal output will look like this, with the spam emails represented by the red dots and the non-spam emails represented by the blue dots. A human or another intelligent algorithm can now come in and make sense of the neural. newly organized data. Another example is, if you want to automatically group news items from various sources into clusters of related news that can be summarized by a single headline. In this case, you will be using some clustering algorithm to group the relevant news and some another intelligent algorithm to summarize the news into a headline. Clustering reduces the original multidimensional data into a single dimension, with all similar examples being assigned to the same value. A more general approach is that of dimensionality reduction, the challenge of representing the instances with fewer dimensions than the original representation, while still retaining the important pieces of information in each example. An example application of dimensionality reduction could be easier visualization of multivariate data while still retaining their nuances. We have already seen an example of dimensionality reduction before. Do you remember? It was the SVD video. If you haven't watched it already, it is the 8th video in the Linear Algebra for Machine Learning series. Today, let's see a different example. Suppose we have the following data set for house values or prices in $1,000 of a certain district. This data set has 4 features or dimensions and is impossible to visualize graphically as a whole. However, if you carefully study the relationship of the features to each other and to themselves, you'll notice that not all features are equally important. For example, can you categorize each house by its floor count? does the number of floors help to distinguish one house from another? It doesn't seem so. Since they are almost equal, that is, they have low variance and thus aren't very helpful. What about households? It doesn't vary much. But its variance is certainly more than floors, and thus this is more helpful. Now for the last two features, area and value, they vary much more, and hence they are more representative than the other two of our data. But there is something we can do to fully exploit each feature to the maximum without sacrificing much accuracy. So far we have studied each feature individually. What about their relation to each other? If you look carefully at the first two features, value and area, you will notice that the value is roughly double the area. This is incredibly useful, for we can now deduce one feature from another and need only one instead of two. This property is called covariance. The higher the covariance, the more the correlated the two features are, which implies redundancy in data. Since there is more information than needed because we can deduce one from the another, and that's what a dimensionality reduction algorithm does. It tries to find another representation of the data and another set of features such that the features in this representation have the highest possible variance and lowest possible covariance. You can now discard the features that are less relevant and train your model with the ones that are more relevant. Another example of unsupervised learning is that of density estimation. The task of estimating the probability density or likelihood of certain observations. Density estimation may be useful to identify if certain observations are commonly expected to occur or if they are rare occurrences, hence supporting tasks such as anomaly detection. These more hands-off and data-driven approach to discovering patterns from unlabeled data is called unsupervised learning. What makes unsupervised learning such an interesting area is that it is an overwhelming majority of the data in this world is unlabeled. Having intelligent algorithms that can take our terabytes and terabytes of unlabeled data and make sense of it is a huge source of potential profit for many industries. That alone could help boost productivity in a number of fields. Yet another broad machine learning paradigm involves identifying the action that will result in the maximum reward under given conditions. For example, driverless cars, autopiloting drones, robotic vacuum cleaners, and game-playing bots are all agents that need to decide on the next steps that will lead to the best outcomes in their particular scenario. This is the field of reinforcement learning. Now that we have discussed the three different categories of machine learning, it is important to note that a lot of times the line between these types of learning blur. More than that, there is a lot of tasks that can easily be phrased as one type of learning and then transformed into another paradigm. The reason for this is that, in the end, all learning is learning. It's simply how we phrase the problem statement. Certain problems are more easily phrased one way or another. That also highlights another interesting idea. We can blend these types of learning, designing components of systems that learn one way or another, but integrate together into one larger algorithm. It's all up to your phrasing of the problem statement. So that is it for today, and this is just the tip of the iceberg. Next video onwards, we will dive into understanding the machine learning algorithms, why they work, how they work, and more. Please leave any questions, comments, or concerns in the comments. Thank you for your time. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you in the next video.